Hello, dear students. Today we are talking about electrocardiography, the most important method to diagnosis of cardiovascular disorders. And today we will focus on basic knowledge of ECG recording and interpretation of ECG. And here is a real patient's ECG, and you see we are recognizing 12 leads. There are 12 leads which consist of standard leads, first, second, and third standard leads, and also we are recognizing augmented leads AVR, AVL, and AVF, and 6 chest leads from V1 to V6. Before getting this kind of picture, we have to connect electrodes of ECG machine with the patient's body. And there are several colored electrodes. For example, red color of electrode we connect with the right arm of patient, yellow color with left arm, green color with left foot, and also we have to connect grounding electrode, which is black color, with the right foot of patient. And after connection, we get so-called Eight-Hovind triangles, which is, I hope you remember from normal physiology classes. ECG leads may be divided into two general types, bipolar leads and unipolar leads. Bipolar leads consist of two electrodes placed at two different sites. These leads register the difference in potential between these two sites. Unipolar leads, in contrast, measure the absolute electrical potential at the one site. And most standard leads from first to third, they are bipolar leads because they register the differences of potential from two electrodes. For example, first lead registers the differences between the arms, second lead between the right arm and left leg, third lead registers differences of potential between the left arm and left leg. Also, we are recognizing unipolar limbs, augmented unipolar lead, AVR lead, registered from one electrode, which is connected with the right hand, AVL from the left hand, and AVF from left foot. Also, we have to connect chest leads, and before connection chest lead, I'd like to remind you chest lines, and you see here anterior middle line, which is divided our sternum into two parts. Also, we are recognizing sternal line, which is going through the border of sternum, and also we know midclavicular line. Midclavicular line divided our clavicle into two parts. Between the midclavicular line and sternal line, we are recognizing parasternal line. Also, we know three axillary lines, anterior, middle axillary, and posterior axillary lines. How we put chest electrodes? First, V1, we put on the 4 intercostal space, see first, second, third, and 4 intercostal space on the right side of sternum. On 4 intercostal space, left side of sternum, we put V2 electrode, and V4 electrode we put on the midclavicular line on the 5th intercostal space. And then between the V2 and V4, on the diagonal between them, we put V3 electrode on parasternal line. And then V5 electrode we put on the 5th intercostal space by anterior axillary line, and V6 on 5th intercostal space again, but by mid-axillary line. And here is again V1, 4 intercostal space to the right side of sternum, V2, 4 intercostal space to the left side of sternum, V3 between the V2 and V4 on V3 but left parasternal line, V4, 5th intercostal space at the mid-clavicular line, V5, 5th intercostal space at the anterior axillary line, and V6, also 5th intercostal space at the mid-axillary line. And here is real patient ECG. Also, ECG is very important because on different kinds of leads we have different information. For example, if you want to assess lateral part of heart, you have to see first lead, AVL lead, V5 and V6. For example, inferior wall, any pathologies, for example, inferior wall myocardial function will represent it on second, third, and AVF leads. V1 and V2 give us information about septum, and V4 and V3 give us information about anterior wall. How far made the ECG picture? ECG picture, we are recognizing different kinds of waves, for example, P wave, Q, R, S, T waves. Also, we have here information of different kinds of segments. Segments located or wise on the isoline. We know PQ segment or P sometimes when absent Q wave. We call this segment as PR segment and also ST segment. Both segments are lies on the isoline. And also we are recognizing intervals. For example, PQ or PR interval, interval includes P wave and PQ segment. And also QT interval also includes the QRS waves and also ST segment and also T wave. Whole generation of impulses started from sinoatrial node. Each minute, sinoatrial nodes produce from 60 to 90 beats impulses, and these impulses generated through the atriums and cause formation of depolarization of atriums. P wave, this is depolarization of atriums, and then impulse reach AV node and pass through the AV node, and AV node deleting of impulses cause PQ segment formation, and then impulse go to the bundle of his and bundle branches, which is located in interventricular septum, and cause depolarization of interventricular septum, and depolarization of interventricular septum cause formation of Q wave. And then impulse reach the apex of heart, and depolarization of apex of heart cause formation of R wave. And S wave, this is depolarization of base of heart. T wave, repolarization of ventricles. Where is the repolarization of atriums? Repolarization of atriums lays on the PQ segment. Okay, on the standard electrocardiography, amplitude is displayed on the scale on 1 millivolt to 10 millimeter vertical displacement. Also, we are recognizing here a time, which is measured by second, and that means duration of P wave, QRS waves, and T wave, and also duration of intervals and segments, we will measure in second, and amplitudes in millimeter. How we interpret ECG? Interpretation of ECG starts from assessing of rhythm. This is rhythm sinus or non-sinus. In the second place, we should assess the regularity, regular or irregular rhythm. And then we should have to calculate heart rate, and then we have to assess excessive heart, and then we should assess any intervals and duration of complexes, and also duration of segments and intervals like QT. First is rhythm. We should assess this is sinus rhythm or non-sinus rhythm. If on your patient ECG you see P wave which is present before the QRS complex, it means before depolarization of ventricles, you have depolarization of atriums. That means sinus node produce impulses and go to the P wave formation and then only QRS formation. And if no, not P wave before QRS complex, it means not sinus rhythm. Here you see our rhythm of our ECG is sinus. Next is, you should check the regularity of rhythm. Rhythm may be regular or irregular. Regular rhythm, when R are interval, they are same are interval, and differences of between the R are less than 10%. For example, you see here differences between R intervals less than 10%. That's why here we have regular rhythm. Sometimes maybe irregular rhythm when differences more than 10%. Next, you should calculate the heart rate, and you see heart rate formula. This is 60 divided into RR interval per second. And to calculation of heart rate, of course, you should know on which speed was recorded ECG. There are two speeds, 50 mm per second or 25 mm per second. Two speeds, and depending on this speed on ECG, we have different kinds of big and small squares. There are big square, and each big square consists of many 25 small squares. And depending on speed of ECG, 50 or 25, we have different duration of these squares. For example, if your patient ECG was registered on speed of 50 mm per second, duration of one big square, it will be 0.1 second, and one small square will be 0.02 second. If your patient ECG was registered in 25 mm per second, duration of one big square, it will be 0.2 second, and duration of small square, it will be 0.04 second. And how you calculate heart rate? For example, your patient's ECG is on 50 mm per second, and ECG speeds dictate us how we calculate the heart rate. You are dividing 60, dividing into the RR interval, small boxes, all small boxes between the RR interval, you multiply into 0.02, and 60 you divide to this sum. Or you can use very simple formula like 600. You are dividing into the big boxes between the RR. Or sometimes if you count small boxes, you can 3000 divide into the small boxes between the RR. Very simple method. I recommend to use 600, just divide into the big boxes between the RR. Or for example, you can if your patient's ECG was registered in speed of 25, you can 60 divide into the RR interval small boxes, which is multiplied to 0.04. Or you can use simple formula, 300 divide into the big squares between the RR. Or if you count small boxes, 1500 to the small boxes. After that, we should detect the heart axis. And a normal heart axis located between the 30 and 70 degree. This is degree's name is alpha angle. Alpha angle, we will further detailed how we can find the alpha angle. And you see, if your patient's alpha angle from 30 to 70, it will be normal axis. From zero degree to 30 plus 30, it will be horizontal position of heart. From 70 to plus 90, it will be vertical position of heart. All horizontal, normal position, vertical position, they are maybe in normal range. For example, horizontal position of heart has many hypersthenic type constitutional type of patients, or vertical position, asthenic type of patients. Also, if f angle, are less than 0 to minus 30, we recognize as left axis deviation. If less than minus 30, it will be extreme left axis deviation. If your patient f angle will be between the plus 90 and plus 20, it will be right axis deviation. If more than 120 degree, it will be extreme right axis deviation. How we find alpha angle? There are several kinds of several ways. First way is the calculation of electrical axis position by two leads, by first lead and third lead. Electrical axis of heart depends on ventricles, that's why we are taking QRS complex, only pure QRS complex. And we should get algebraic sum of whole QRS complexes. Whole base which is over the isoline has positive mark, whole base which is under the isoline has minus mark. And we have to calculate, we have to count the amplitudes of millimeters. For example, a Q wave minus 2 millimeters. R wave plus 6 millimeters. And S wave minus 3. And we got sum plus 1. Next, on the third lead, we also take QRS complex. QRS minus 1 plus 3 and minus 5, and we got also sum minus 3. And on the table, plus 1 and minus 3, we have to find. For example, on the first lead, here is first lead, here is third lead, again third lead and first lead, plus 1 and minus 3. Minus 3, we are checking crossing point of minus 3 and plus, and we got minus 70. And where is our minus 70? Minus 70 on this zone. Minus 70, that's why our patient's ECGs has extreme left axis deviation. Or you can use another method. Another method, if your patient, the maximum, if you take whole three standard leads and maximum R will be on the second lead, which belongs to normal QRS axis, and R on the third and on the third lead, R and S wave, they are same. If your patients, the biggest R will be on the third lead, the biggest R on the third lead, this belongs to the vertical heart position. And horizontal heart position, if your patient or axis deviation, left axis deviation, if your patient's the biggest R will be on the first lead. Or you can use another method to assessing the assessing of QRS complex on the two leads, first lead and AVF leads. If on the first lead we have predominance of the positive component, and in AVF also predominance of positive components, positive and positive, give us normal axis. If your patient has predominance of negative component on the first lead and predominance of positive component on the AVF lead, it will be right axis deviation. And left axis deviation, if your patients are predominantly has positive component on first lead and in AVF minus, this is negative AVF, that's why it will be left axis deviation. Okay, what is this? Let's see, on the first lead we have positive, and between the positive first lead and positive AVF, we have positive first lead and positive AVF, that's why it will be in this range. Your patient's axis may be less in horizontal or in normal or in vertical position. It will be normal. If your patient has positive on first lead and negative on AVF lead, It will be based on this reason, region, atopic left axis deviation. All your patient has positive in AVF and negative in B or in first lead, it will be based on right axis deviation zone. For example, see, here is ECG of with a normal axis. You see the biggest R on the second lead, the biggest R if you take three centered leads. And also you see on first lead we have positive component, prevalence of positive, and on AVF also positive, and also the biggest R on the second lead give us normal axis. Let's see here, you see the biggest R if you take standard lead on the third lead. Also you see on the first lead we have predominance of negative component, and AVF give us predominance of positive component, and this is right axis deviation. Next page, you see the biggest R on the first lead at the end, also first lead predominantly positive, and AVF we have predominantly negative. And positive on first lead, negative on AVF give us left axis deviation. Okay, next is assessing the waves and intervals. Here is P wave. You know P wave represents as atrium. Atriums, both atriums, right and left side, and P wave duration should be not more than 0.12, maximum 0.0, not more than, average is 0.1 of P wave. And also we should assess the PQ interval. PQ interval includes P wave and PQ segment. And duration of this PQ interval may change in different kinds of arrhythmias, like AV blockages, second degree, third degree, different kinds of AV blockages. Duration, normal duration of this PQ or PR, if absent Q, PR interval is from 0.12 to 0.2 second. And also we should recognize, and sometimes we have to calculate Marcos index. This is Marcos index relation of P wave and PQ or PR segment. This should be between the 1.1 to 1.6. Duration of QRS complex normally should be within 0.06 till 0.12. Represent as working of ventricles. This is QRS complex. Amplitude is from 5 to 22 millimeters in lip leads. In precordial leads, it should be between the 5 to 25 millimeters. If in standard leads we have less than 5, and in chest leads less than 7, it will be low amplitude ECG. Q wave, normally Q wave. Duration should be duration should be less than 0.04 second, and amplitude should be not more than 1/4 amplitude of our wave in same leads, because sometimes we have pathological Q when duration exceeds 0.04 and amplitudes also increase and will be deep Q wave. This Q wave character for myocardial infarction. In lead V1 till V3, Q wave is absent. If present in this lead, it means myocardial infarction. In lead V4 to V6, Q wave is present, but duration should be, and amplitude should be in normal range. In lead AVR, Q wave may be deep and wide. This is a character for normal range. R wave amplitude of R wave in V4 is maximum. And if you see chest leads, you see the maximum R wave normally should be on V4 lead. And you see on V1, we have depressed, and V2 also depressed, and also deep, and we have increasing from V1 R, and then again decreasing. And also we should recognize the transition zone, normal transition zone located in V3 lead. What is transition zone? Transition zone when R wave and S wave, they have similar amplitude of R wave, similar to S wave. And this transition zone may change. If transition zone shift to the right side, it may occur in the left ventricular hypertrophy. When transition zone shift to the V5, for example, that's mostly character for right ventricular hypertrophy. Also, to recognize the different disturbances, you should know ventricular activation time. Ventricular activation time at the time from the beginning of QRS complex to the peak of the R wave is called ventricular activation time. Normally, ventricular activation time will checked in chest leads. And chest leads, this is if V1, V2 should be not more than 0.03. If you check the V5, V6 leads, which belongs to left side, less than 0.05. In case of right ventricular hypertrophy, in V1, V2, ventricular activation time will increase and will exceed more than 0.03. In case of left ventricular hypertrophy, ventricular activation time will increase in V5 and V6. S wave in leads V1 to V4, amplitude of S wave is progressively decreased. Amplitude of S wave is maximal in lead V1, and S wave is of low amplitude or it's absent in waves V5 and V6. Amplitude of S wave should be less than 20 millimeters. Also, we should be able assessing ST segment, ventricular recovery, onset of ST segment in the junction or G point. Here is G point. And in limp leads, ST segment is at the level of baseline or may be displaced less than 1 millimeter upward or less than 0.5 millimeters downward. In this V1 to V3, ST segment may be displaced less than 1 millimeter upward. In leads V4 to V6, ST segment may be displaced less than 0.5 millimeters downward. And you see here displacing of or elevation or depression. Here is depression of ST segment. Here is abnormal depression of ST segment, which is may occur in, for example, angina pectoris. And also you see elevation of ST segment more than 1 millimeter, which corrected for myocardial infarction. That's why it's very important take get a G point and also get segment depression or segment elevation. QT interval, it includes the total duration of ventricular activation and recovery, and in general sense correspond to the duration of ventricular action potential. We call QT interval as electrical system of heart. The duration of QT interval decreases as heart rate increases. And here is also one formula for calculating corrected QT interval. It's also a very important interval. QT interval, corrected QT interval. In normal range, it should be 0.35 to 0.46 in male and 0.35 to 0.47 second in female. And here is whole normal duration of PR or PQ interval, QRS duration, QT interval, RR interval, and etc. You have to remember all these interval to assess. And let's discuss ECG of real patient. For example, we got likely CCG. And now we know what we should do. We, at the beginning, we should assess the regularity of rhythm, and then you see regular, this also sinus or not. Assessing of sinus or not, we should find out P wave before QRS complex. You see QRS P wave present before QRS complex. Also anywhere P wave before QRS complex. That's why our rhythm is sinus. Next is regular or not. You see RR between the RR. You see about 3.5 boxes between the RR, similar RR. And that's why distances between RR similar, rhythm is regular. Also, let's calculate the heart rate. To this, we should know speed. Here is speed 25 mm per second. If our speed is 25 mm per second, it means duration of our one big box is 0.2. And see, here is 3.5 big boxes between the two RR complexes, RR complexes. That's why how we can calculate. We can use a simple formula: 300 divided into 3.5 big boxes. 3.5 big boxes. 300 into 3.5. It will be 85 per minute. Also, we should assess the excess of heart. Of course, we can calculate the alpha angle getting algebraic sum from first and third lead, but let's use the very useful way, very simple way. For example, on first lead we see the biggest R, and also we see on first lead we have positive component, prevalence of positive component, and prevalence of negative component in AVF. That's why we are assessing as a left axis deviation. And here we see normal range of P, also less than 0.1, PQ also about 0.18, and QRS also duration is normal. Anywhere I couldn't see any deformities and don't see ST segment elevation or depression. As a result, our ECG interpretation. First, rhythm is sinus because P before QRS, rhythm is regular, rate is 85 beats per minute, left axis deviation, alpha angle minus 20, intervals PR 0.18, QRS 0.1, and Q correlated QT less than 0.46. We finished our lecture. Dear students, thank you for your attention. If you have questions, you know how you can ask to me. Bye.